نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. Now we started talking about what we could call the third stage that fiqh went through after the main stage or the original stage, which was the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this stage, we said, it stretches from around 120, 130 after Hijrah till around 270, which is roughly the time when the Abbasid Caliphate or the Khilaf al-Abbasiyya was on its last legs. And during this time, the madhahib appeared, because we said there was what we could call tadween al-hadith. So the main books of hadith started being established. And famously we say Muwatta al-Imam Malik and Musnad al-Imam Ahmad. And so these collections of hadith were there. Hadith was written down. There were a lot of collections in circulation. People had access to them. So that helped fiqh take a very particular and well-defined shape. And as a consequence as well, there was what we can call as well tadween al-fiqh. Tadween al-fiqh. So the fiqh started to take a very clear shape, and the scholars started to actually write down their opinions, their fiqhi opinions, because fiqh was mainly taught from teacher to student, from teacher to student. There was no books on fiqh. There was no books on fiqhi issues and on rulings. So during this period as well, the scholars or the students, sometimes the students of those scholars, started writing down the opinions of their scholars and classifying these opinions under headings. And so thus was tadween al-fiqh as well, the writing down of al-fiqh, or creating fiqh compilations or collections, books of fiqh. And that time as well, there was the Al-Khilaf al-Abbasiyya, and Muslim countries, Muslim cities were very well established. There was a huge cultural development and intellectual development. So even the books of the different civilizations were translated into Arabic. So we have the Indian books were translated, Persian books were translated, Greek and Roman philosophy was also translated into Arabic, and there was such a powerful, huge intellectual movement around the Arab world. So when in Khilaf al-Abbasiyya, the Caliph created what they called Baytul Hikmah. Baytul Hikmah was more of a university, and it's actually bigger even than a university. It was a university and a universal research center. House of Wisdom, Baytul Hikmah, yes. Was more of a think tank as well. So there was a lot of intellectual activity. Translations were taking place, teaching was taking place, thinking and coming up with new theories, new philosophies was also taking place. Different sciences like medicine improved greatly. So all the different disciplines, and scholars were given a lot of privileges, intellectuals were respected, and they were given even salaries just for the sake of devoting their time completely for their studies. So that caused some kind of an intellectual revolution. Part of this as well was all of this cultural and, you know, intellectual kind of sophistication got the scholars as well to establish fiqh according to principles, teach it in a very respectable, organized, systematic fashion. So that developed as well. And also gave sometimes language. It gave language to what otherwise was more of a culture, was more of a personal opinion. So this kind of organization that some these other sciences or these philosophies had that were taken from other civilizations, they showed a great deal of system and organization and complexity and classification. So this also, I would say, you know, put the level of intellectualism among the Muslims even higher. So they started comparing their own products, intellectual products, or fiqh even products, comparing them to this kind of sophistication. So that helped push the level of fiqh, or the presentation, I would say, the documentation of fiqh, to a more sophisticated level, more organized level. So this was one of the contributing factors. And we find, for example, with Imam al-Shafi'i, that because fiqh was opinions, people would look at the Quran, look at the hadith, and different verses, different hadith that pertain to this issue that they're studying, and then they would come up with a ruling that's based on their understanding. Now, Imam al-Shafi'i took that a point further when he actually distilled these rulings of these rules of deduction. What are the basic rulings at the back end of this understanding that caused the scholars to come up with this ruling from these verses? So thus, he created what we call ilm usul al-fiqh, the science of the principles of fiqh. And it's more like grammar for language. It's more like grammar for language. Well, just one example on usul al-fiqh, for example. Al-amru lil-wujub. This is a rule in usul al-fiqh. When there is an imperative, when there is a verb that says do, that signifies obligation. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uses any verb in the imperative form, that means obligation. Unless there is an indication in this hadith or in this verse or in another text that shows that this imperative or this verb does not mean obligation, it actually means recommendation. This is one of the rules of fiqh. How do you do this? That's how the scholars used to understand. So Imam al-Shafi'i looked at all of this collectively and he deduced this rule. He found it as a consistent pattern. So he deduced it into a very simple stated rule that the imperative verb or form of the verb, the imperative form of the verb indicates obligation. Unless there is another indication or another clue that suggests otherwise. Al-amru lil-wujub illa idha waradat qarinatun sarifa. إِلَّا إِذَا وَرَدَتْ قَرِينَةٌ صَارِفَةٌ. For example, somebody might say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Jumu'ah, فَإِذَا قُضِيَتِ الصَّلَاةُ فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. So when the Salah, when Jumu'ah, prayer, is completed, فَانْتَشِرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. So spread over the earth. That means pursue your وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ. So spread, like leave the masjid. You don't have to stay in the masjid. Leave the masjid. And وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ, and try to get your provision that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written for you. So that means go and make a living, go and do your business, go and do some work. Somebody might say, okay, this is what? فَانْتَشِرُوا, انْتَشِرُوا is an imperative, spread. That means leave the masjid, spread on the earth, disperse. وَابْتَغُوا مِنْ فَضْلِ اللَّهِ, and seek the provision of Allah. That means you have to go to work after Jumu'ah. That's an obligation. But we say no. Because why? There is an indication that this imperative verb does not mean obligation. Why? Because it was preceded by a prohibition. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the verse before that, He says, إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمُعَةِ, if the adhan is called for Jumu'ah, or if it's time for Jumu'ah, فَاسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, so rush to the remembrance of Allah. That means come to the prayer. That's an obligation. Come to the prayer. فَاسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ, and leave business, trade, work. Leave it. That's an imperative verb and that's an obligation, because there's no indication that says, okay, if you want, you can come. No, you have to come. So that's an obligation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it obligatory on the Muslim males to come to the masjid at Jum'ah time. And if they have work or business, anything that engaged in, they have to leave it and they have to come to the masjid. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to say, you don't have to stay in this masjid for the rest of your life. Now you come, Allah is going to say, now go. So the second one is to cancel, the second order is to cancel the first one after a period of time, which is towards the end of the prayer. When the prayer is done, okay, now the obligation that we said, come to the masjid and stay there, now this is cancelled by another order. So this is Nusul al-Fiqh. Al-Amru إِذَا جَاءَ بَعْدَ حَضْرٍ فَلَيْسَ لِلْوُجُوبِ إِنَّمَا هُوَ لِرَفْعِ الْوُجُوبِ. So if a command comes, if an imperative verb comes in the text, and it comes after an obligation that was made, it comes to lift the first obligation. So if you want after Jum'ah, you can stay in the masjid, or you can leave, it's up to you. Because the first obligation that you come to the masjid, you stay in the masjid, now was lifted at the time of when the prayer is completed. So that's just an example on Usul al-Fiqh. So this kind of sophistication, this kind of depth in looking at the logic behind how the understanding of the scholars, how they would take a ruling from the text, how they would handle the text in order to arrive at a ruling, this kind of understanding, Imam Shafi'i was the first to write someone there. So this kind of, I would say, although our sophistication has some negative connotations, but I'm not talking about the negative connotations. I'm talking about the development. I'm talking about that the systemic nature of nature that fiqh assumed at that time. It became more organized, very well defined. Headings were created, subcategories were created, and so on and so forth. Because the hadith was documented, it was more accessible. It was more accessible to people. And it was more accessible to people in different countries. Let's say, for example, the hadith of Abdullah bin Mas'ud, the hadith that were reported by Abdullah bin Mas'ud, because Abdullah bin Mas'ud lived in Al-Kufa. So they were accessible to the people of Iraq because they could come and meet Abdullah bin Mas'ud or meet his students and learn these hadith. But they were not accessible to the people in Medina or the people in Egypt. So when they were written down as collections of hadith, copies were made of them so that now they were more accessible. This also, as we said, added to the development of fiqh. So the scholars in different, or the fuqaha in different countries, now they had access to ahadith, more ahadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And this caused them to share their fiqh and build a school of thought around it and start teaching it to students. And students would write down on document. And this is exactly what happened with Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, and Imam Shafi'i, and Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. Not only these four, but there were more. There were more, and probably in the Abu Amina Bilal Philips book, you will find probably Imam al-Awza'i, and I think Sufyan al-Thawri, he talks about their madhahib. So each of the well-established scholars, they had madhahib, they had a school of thought, very well, a clear system about fiqh and the rulings. And they had a huge number of students who actually learned from them and started, you know, following their footsteps. So this is basically, this is what marks this time. So it was very well, fiqh was very well established at this time. It became a very well established science. It became a science on its own. It had clear borders. And somehow at this stage, it sort of made a complete split from aqeedah. Because you remember, at the early stages we said fiqh means understanding, means deep, proper comprehension. And it included, at the early stages, issues of what we call fiqh today, which is the practical rulings of Islam. Something is halal or haram. Is it permissible to do this? Is it wajib? Is it recommended? Is it disliked? Okay. And it also included issues of aqidah, issues of belief, belief about the unseen. All of these were called fiqh. But at this stage, now fiqh, when you said fiqh, khalas, this term became very exclusive to what we call al-ahkam al-amaliyya, which is these practical rulings of either ibadat, where acts of worship, or dealings among people, the business transactions, or marriages, or family relationships, etc. So in order to have a very good understanding and of this, we will take a glimpse into the form madhahab. A glimpse into the form madhahab. So we will talk about the main figure in the madhab, which are the four imams, and then a little bit about them, about their life, and then a little bit about the main characteristics, features about their madhab and about their fiqh. So we'll start obviously with Abu Hanifa. I found a very good description. I was trying to research into this, and I found one of the Arabic references, Tariq al-Tashri' al-Islami, the history of Islamic legislation by Manna' al-Qattan. I found that it gave very, very good brief yet comprehensive description of each of them, so I'll depend heavily on it. And I think what you find in Bilal Philips' book is quite good as well. So Abu Hanifa was born around 80 after Hijrah. Was born around 80 after Hijrah. His name is An-Nu'man bin Thabit. An-Nu'man bin Thabit. And he is Persian in origin. He's Persian in origin. His father was born as a Muslim. His father was born as a Muslim. His father, Thabit, was born as a Muslim. So Abu Hanifa was born into a Muslim family as well. And he was born 80 after Hijrah. And he was in Iraq. And I believe he was born in Al-Kufa. And at Kufa, we said it had the knowledge mainly of Abdullah bin Mas'ud. Iraq got the knowledge of Abdullah bin Mas'ud. So Abu Hanifa learned from the students of Abdullah bin Mas'ud mainly from the students, especially at the early stages of his studies. So he learned from Ibrahim al-Nakhai and some other students of Abdullah bin Mas'ud. But these are not the only ones that he learned from. Later on, he stretched his learning scope even to other students of other companions. So he lived, he was born into the Umayyad Caliphate, and he witnessed that. And he witnessed during his early years the days of Al-Hajjaj, who was very harsh and vicious against the population, or against the people who were rebellious towards the Umayyad Caliphate. And then he witnessed also the time of Umar bin Abdul Aziz, the Khilafah of Umar bin Abdul Aziz. Then he witnessed the decline of Banu Umayyah and how the Abbasid Khilafah took over. Abbasid Khilafah took over. So he witnessed that. He saw all of these events. Iraq was a very rich place in terms of business and trade, and in terms of the intellectual movement. So it was, even some of them said it was hadiratul alam al-islami. It was more of the hub of the Muslim world. And it was basically the hub of the world, Iraq at that time. So all business, all trade, everything was actually taking place mainly in Iraq. Mainly in Iraq. So this also added a lot of variety and a lot of depth and a lot of knowledge to Imam Abu Hanifa, living in that hub. So he saw a lot of cultures, you know, coming into this place, and he had exposure to all of these cultures, whether they be they Arabic or Persian or even Indian or even European, in terms of like Greek and Roman philosophies. So all of them were, so Iraq was a more of a melting pot of these cultures. So Abu Hanifa, Imam Abu Hanifa, had an exposure to all of these. And this obviously enhanced his intelligence, his intellectual level, his ability to, you know, handle things and to even have a deep understanding of what he was studying. And you remember when we said previously that two schools of thought were taking place in Iraq, one which was Madrasatul Ra'i, and in Al-Hijaz, mainly in Medina, was Madrasatul Al-Hadith. Madrasatul Ahl al-Hadith. Ahl al-Ra'i in Iraq, Ahl al-Hadith. Ahl al-Ra'i were people who focused so much on the meanings of the texts, and they were able to discuss meanings and even come up with some scenarios, try to find out solutions for them. So they extended the meanings of the texts and they expounded on them, and they tried to see what the meanings were telling them. So Abu Hanifa, being in Iraq, obviously he was influenced by that. He was influenced by that. So he would use intellect to understand what the text is talking about. What is the meaning behind it? What is the wisdom behind it? So, and this will all reflect on the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. So the ones that he learned mainly from is Alqama al-Nakha'i, or Ibrahim al-Nakha'i. And his main teacher at the beginning was Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman. Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman. And these were all from the school of Iraq, which is Madrasatu Ahl al-Ra'i. So he inherited from them a deep understanding into the text, a very deep understanding and analysis of the text, of the religious text. The fuqaha at that time were respected a lot, and they were given their status because it's a Muslim caliphate. So the scholars of Islam occupied a very high position. They were praiseworthy, they were respected, they occupied a high status in society. So everyone looked up to them. Did Abu Hanifa meet any of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ? This is an issue of dispute, but the majority of the scholars of Al-Rijal, the scholars who studied, you know, the scholars and the narrators of hadith, they, most of them, they say no, he did not meet any of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. Although he lived during the times of Anas bin Malik and some of the other companions, but most likely he did not meet them. So he's considered to be from Kibar Tabi'i Tabi'in. Tabi'i Tabi'in. Okay, but one of the senior ones among them. He began his life more as a merchant, so he used to sell fabric and silk. So he was a businessman, more of a merchant. And there's a lot of beautiful stories about him when he was a merchant, about his honesty and his concern even for people. Sometimes he would, like, there's a famous story about a lady who came to sell like some kind of a dress that she had, but she was in need of money. So she wanted to sell that dress, and he asked her, how much do you want for that? Well, she said, probably 4 dirham. He said, oh, no, I'm not gonna pay 4 dirham for this kind of dress. She said, how much you wanna pay? 4 dirham is not much. She thought he was gonna, you know, argue with her, bargain with her, get a better deal. He said, I'm gonna give it to you. As far as I believe, it was 50 dinar, something like this. It was such a huge amount of money. And she said, why? He said, this is made of silk. It's not made from normal fabric. So it's worth much more than that. Obviously, it wasn't worth, I can't remember exactly the number, was it 50 or something like that? But he gave her more than its own worth. He realized she was a woman in need. So a lot of stories came from Abu Hanifa about his honesty and about his care for people. So Abu Hanifa started more as a merchant. And then when he saw the students of knowledge, the scholars, this appealed to him. So he decided to study and pursue it more. So he started actually attending the halaqat, learning the hadith, learning the fiqh, etc. And he excelled. And we said the main person that he studied with was Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman. Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman, who was the main faqih of Iraq, the main alim or scholar of Iraq. He also, we said, studied with Ibrahim al-Nakhai and Alqama al-Nakhai. But Abu Hanifa also studied with other mashayikh. So he studied from with Ata' ibn Abi Rabah, one of the main students of Ibn Abbas. Ata' ibn Abi Rabah, well-known mufassir. And he studied with Ikrima, the student as well, who, the servant of Ibn Abbas. He studied also with Nafi', the servant of Ibn Umar. With Nafi', Mawla ibn Umar, the servant of Ibn Umar. Nafi' as well was one of the main scholars of his time. He also studied under some of the scholars from Ahl al-Bayt, like Ja'far al-Sadiq and Zayd bin Ali. And by the way, these scholars were from Ahl al-Sunnah. The descendants of Ali ibn Abi Talib were from Ahl al-Sunnah. Were from Ahl al-Sunnah. Abu Hanifa was known for his courage as well in truth. Was known for his courage in truth. And many times he was asked to become a judge. And he refused. He refused to become a judge. He wanted to spend his time studying and teaching. And he did not want to be in a position where someone had authority over him. Especially so he didn't want to get into political issues that might put some pressure on him. So he avoided that, and he was punished actually by this. So this is why the Amir, or the governor of Iraq at the time of the Umayyad Caliphate, Yazid ibn Amr ibn Hubayra, he wanted Abu Hanifa to become a qadi or a judge, and he refused. So he actually punished him, and he made him, he whipped him in public. 110 lashes, 10 each time, each day, every day, for 11 days. He was whipped 110 lashes. So when he saw that Imam Abu Hanifa was completely decisive about not taking up that position, they let him go. And also later on, during the Abbasid Khilafah, Al-Khalifa himself, the Caliph himself, wanted him to become a judge. And they actually invited him to come to move to Baghdad. This is why he moved to Baghdad. And we know that he died in Baghdad. He died, and his grave is in Baghdad today. So the Khalifa wanted him to become a judge. And he said no. So the Khalifa said, Wallahi, you will become a judge. Wallahi, you will become a judge. So in order to put him under pressure, he said, Wallahi, I will not become a judge. So he was known for his bravery in that sense. He was clear about what he wanted to do. So some of the people around, they said, you know, you can't make the Khalifa expiate for his own oath. He said, why? The Khalifa is more capable than me, you know, to pay the expiation. So he's supposed to pay it. And the Khalifa saw that, he said, just let him go. Let him go, he won't take it. But it wasn't easy for him. He was put in prison a few times because of this as well. And he was known for his ibadah. He was known for his worship. And there's a story about him that one day he was praying at night, and he prayed the whole night reciting one verse, and he was crying all the time. And it was when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qamar, بَلِ السَّاعَةُ مَوْعِدُهُمْ وَالسَّاعَةُ أَدْهَى وَأَمَرْ بَلِ السَّاعَةُ مَوْعِدُهُمْ. Indeed, their appointment, the time for them, is the last day, is the hour. وَالسَّاعَةُ أَدْهَى وَأَمَرْ. And how heavy and weighty and bitter that hour will be. وَالسَّاعَةُ أَدْهَى وَأَمَرْ. Abu Hanifa was known as well for his intelligence, high level of intelligence. And his teaching style stood out. He did not throw information on students. His class was mainly discussion. So he would ask questions, he would get the students to think and give him answers, then he would make comments on their answers and help them find the right answer. That was his way, his style of teaching. That's how he used to teach. So he got the people to think. He got his students to think. One day he was with his students, and some of the Khawarij came into the masjid. And those Khawarij were basically attacking Muslims, some Muslims at the time. Because we know during the Abbasid Khilafah, and even the Umayyad Caliphate, some of the Khawarij were still there and would attack some of the cities among the Muslims and attack the government, etc., and so on and so forth. So they entered the masjid in a state of war. So they wanted to see these people who live under the reign of this caliphate. For them, is all of these are non-Muslims. So they walked into the masjid. The students of Imam Abu Hanifa panicked and said, "What should we do now? They caught us in the masjid." He said, "You just stay quiet. I'll deal with them." Obviously, he's a very intellectual person and very knowledgeable. He knows the Khawarij, he knows how they think. So they came and they said, "Who are you?" They asked Abu Hanifa and these guys, "Who are you guys?" He said, "Nahnu mustajirun." We are mustajirun. We seek your protection. That's what he said. And basically understands these people, the Khawarij, they take the Quran for letter. Even sometimes against the original meaning, but because they don't understand. So he was referring to the verse in Surah Tawbah, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ إِسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. So if one of the, that's what the verse suggests, when one of the non-Muslims seeks your protection, so give him your protection, grant him protection, protect them. Until they hear the words of Allah. ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَهُ. Then get them to a safe place. So help them get to a safe place. So Abu Hanifa knows if he said we're Muslims, they were going to kill them. Why? Because for them you're kuffar. But he basically said, "We are mustajirun. We are people who are seeking your help." So they assumed, "Oh, he's a non-Muslim, came into the masjid seeking help." So they left them. So that shows you his understanding and his intelligence as well. One day there's a very interesting story. Abu Hanifa was ill for some time. And one of his main students, Abu Yusuf al-Qadi. Abu Yusuf al-Qadi was very fascinated with his teacher, with Imam Abu Hanifa, and he learned a lot from him, but he was very keen to become a teacher as well. Too early, he wanted to teach early. So when Abu Hanifa was ill, Abu Yusuf started making, you know, his own halaqa. So when Imam Abu Hanifa came back, Abu Yusuf kept his halaqa, and Abu Hanifa had his halaqa. So he became more of a competitor. Right? So Abu Hanifa had his halaqa here, and Abu Yusuf al-Qadi had his halaqa here, his students there. Imam Abu Hanifa, being a wise man, it's not that he felt threatened or insecure that, okay, Abu Yusuf is having a halaqa. He's not. But he knows Abu Yusuf is not ready yet. He's not ready yet. So he wants him to learn more before he gets to that stage. So he says to one of the students, "Go and ask him this question." So He gives him the question. He says, someone bought a piece of cloth. He took it to the tailor and he said, "I want you to make me a thawb. I want you to make me a thawb." He said, "Okay." He said, "You come and pick it up in a few days." So when he came, he said, "Where's my thawb?" He said, "Which thawb?" He said, "I gave you a piece of cloth in order to make it to a thawb. You took the measurements." He said, "No, you didn't. You didn't." So he denied that. He denied that. So he takes him to the qadi, to the judge, and the judge checks, and he finds actually the thawb is being made. So what is the case now? What is the case? What's the answer? Should he just take the thawb without paying to him? Because he took his own property, like the tailor took the piece of cloth for him without, you know, paying. He was meant to tailor the thawb for that person, but he tailored it probably for himself or someone else. We don't know. So should the customer pay the tailor and take the thawb? Or should he take the thawb without paying? Or what should be done? So basically, the guy went with the question. So he said to Abu Yusuf, he said, okay, that's the case, what should we do? What should be the judgment? He said, no, he takes the thawb and he pays for the handwork, for the work of the tailor. He says, wrong, that's the wrong answer. So the student himself, because he was instructed by Abu Hanifa, he said, whatever answer he gives you, tell him wrong. He's going to give you another answer, tell him also wrong. So he said, let me think. So he thought about it, he said, no, he takes it and he doesn't pay as a punishment, because the tailor, okay, intended to take it. So as a punishment, no, he takes his piece of cloth in the shape of thawb, he takes it and doesn't pay for that, because the tailor did not make it for him, so he doesn't pay for him. So the student looked at him and he said, wrong. So Abu Yusuf thought and he said, that's not from you, who sent you? He said, Abu Hanifa sent me. So he realized, he understood the lesson, and he said, I'm not ready. So he said to his students, you want to learn? Go and join Abu Hanifa's halaqah. Let's go and learn. It's not time for me. So he goes and he rejoins the halaqah of Abu Hanifa. But that's still in his mind. He says to Abu Hanifa, you know, what's the answer? That puzzled him, right? What's the answer to this? He said, Abu Hanifa, and you see the understanding. He said, the qadi looks at the thawb. So if the thawb is made according to the measurements of the customer, he pays him. The customer pays and he takes the thawb. But if the tailor, if the design of the thawb, the measurements are designed according to the tailor himself or someone else, he takes it, the customer takes the thawb, and he doesn't pay for it. Why? Because he did not make it for him. He did not make it for him. So basically he's taking his piece of cloth back, okay? That's it, he's taking his piece of cloth back without paying anything. That's what it means. Because the tailor did not make it for him, so he does not owe him anything. That shows depth of understanding, right? So that's an example from, this is how he would teach his students, generally speaking. That would be his style. Let's look at the principles of the madhab of Abu Hanifa. What are the general features of the madhab of Abi Hanifa, rahimahullah? First of all, his main source of legislation is the Qur'an. So he takes that, the Qur'an. And for him, the sunnah comes second. And that's obvious. That's obvious. The second source, we said, is the sunnah, but there's an issue here, and that's the second feature of Abu Hanifa's madhab, especially at his time. He was very careful before accepting hadith. Why? Because there was a lot of lying. There was a lot of fabricated hadith, specifically in Iraq. There was a lot. Because that's the time when the Rafida as well were making up hadith, making up lots of hadith. So Abu Hanifa was very careful, very strict. He had very strict measures for accepting hadith. And unfortunately, this caused some people to accuse Abu Hanifa of rejecting hadith. There are some people who accused Abu Hanifa of rejecting hadith, but actually he did not reject hadith, but he was very careful. He would scrutinize any narration that would come before accepting it. So he was very careful about accepting hadith, and this, as I said, caused some people to of rejecting hadith. And this obviously caused the number of hadith that were available to be fewer in number. So obviously when he has an issue he has to deal with and he doesn't have a hadith about it, he will use ijtihad, he will use qiyas. And this led to the third feature of Abu Hanifa's madhab, which is a lot of use of qiyas, analogy. Like the abundance of qiyas in his madhab. The abundance of qiyas in his madhab. And that makes sense because he comes from Iraq, from Madrasatul Ra'i, Ahl al-Ra'i. So this is التوسع في القياس. There's abundance of qiyas. There's a lot of qiyas in the madhab. A fourth feature about it is what they call in usul al-fiqh al-istihsan. Al-istihsan. And this is not an easy word to translate, but it would be like, if you find something good, that's for you. Okay, if it makes sense and it seems to be good, that would be the ruling. That would be the Islamic ruling. So creating a ruling or finding coming up with a ruling based on how beneficial the thing is. How beneficial you find it to be. So al-istihsan is one of the main features of Abu Hanifa's madhab. So if something is beneficial, okay, you have two possibilities about something. He would see which is more beneficial, more just, okay, and he would say that's the ruling. If he has no text about it. And this is one of the main contentions between madhab Abi Hanifa and other madhahib. Okay, specifically Shafi'i. Shafi'i was against this. A fifth feature is what they call in Arabic al-hiyal al-shar'iyya. And al-hiyal al-shar'iyya, this is very difficult to translate because it might be easily misunderstood. It is the most accurate, I would say, description or interpretation I could come up with is finding a means to ease. Finding the means, the religious means, to ease. Because al-hiyal in the Arabic language is a very versatile word. Some people translate it as tricks. But in Madhab Abu Hanifa, it's not tricks. He's not talking about tricks, playing tricks. No, he's talking about finding means to find, or coming up with means to finding ease. I'll give some examples to make this, inshallah, more understandable. Finding the means, for example, we find this in the Quran. Prophet Ayyub, alayhi salam, when he was ill, he made an oath to, if he gets his strength back, what will he do? He will lash his wife. Because she said something and she did something. He said he would lash her 100 times. 100 times. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Ayyub recovered, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَخُذْ بِيَدِكَ ضِغْثًا فَضْرِبْ بِهِ وَلَا تَحْنَثْ. He said, you take in your hand a bunch of 100 sticks, thin sticks, and you basically lash your wife once, and that's 100, it counts for 100. So that's a means to ease. You see what we're talking about? That's what's called al-hiyal al-shar'iyya in Arabic. Some people translate it as tricks. It's not tricks, okay? It is means to ease. Religious means to finding ease in a situation. There is also, for example, the Prophet ﷺ, when they conquered Khaybar, some dates were brought to the Prophet ﷺ, and it was called, this type of date is called Junaib. And it's a very good type of dates. It's a very good type of dates. So the Prophet said, is all the dates in Khaybar of that same quality? They said, no. The Prophet said, no. So they said, so how do you deal with that? They said, one sa', or let's say one kg of this, we exchange it with three kg of another type, which is lesser type. The Prophet said, don't do this. This is riba. This is riba al-fadl. Yeah, this is one type of riba. This is one type of riba. But the Prophet said, there's a way to deal with this. You sell this 1 kg of junaib, and it's worth what? $10? $10. And the other 3 kg of that lesser type is also worth $10. So he said, okay, you sell this for $10, you get the $10, then with the $10, you buy that 3 kg of the other type. So this is finding a means to ease. This is called al-hiyal al-shar'iyya. Okay, so Abu Hanifa was very good at this, was very good at finding cases or like legitimate exits from difficult situations. For example, one of the issues that he dealt with was someone made an oath that he will approach his wife and have an intimate relationship have intercourse with her during Ramadan, during one of the days of Ramadan. It's a very strange oath. What someone said, I'm going to approach my wife during one of the days of Ramadan. What made him do this? I don't know. But why would you get into this? Because obviously, you know, the kafara for this is huge. The kafara for this is huge. So they approached Abu Hanifa. They said, you know, get us out of this, you know, get me out of this. What can I do? Because I made an oath to approach, okay, he made an oath to approach his wife during one of the days of Ramadan. So Abu Hanifa, what does Abu Hanifa say? He says, okay, now what you do, you travel with your wife during Ramadan. When you're traveling, you don't have to fast, you can approach her. You see? That's Abu Hanifa. Another example that came to him, a woman, I don't know what happened between her and her husband, but there was a ladder in the house. Probably she wanted to get something from the ceiling, from the roof. So she got, she started climbing the ladder. When she was halfway through, her husband sees her and he says, "Anti taliqun idha sa'atti wa taliqun idha nazalti." He says, you are divorced if you go up, and you're divorced if you go down. Now she's stuck. What does she do? What does she do? So Abu Hanifa said, okay, there's a way to deal with this. Can anyone think of a solution? No, jump is coming down. That's it.
Move the ladder.
So yes, he said, you get a bunch of people, they hold the ladder, they bring the ladder down, they bring the ladder and the woman down on the floor. So she's safe now. So this is basically some of the, that's what they call al-hiyal. Al-hiyal al-shar'iyya, which is seeking means to find ease. Okay, we said Abu Hanifa was accused of, by some people.
Yeah.
No, hila or hila is basically min al-haylula. Haylula means transition. Something, you take something from one state to the other.
Not
hal. Huh? No, no.
Not the word hal.
It could be. Hal is the same thing. Hal is actually arriving from a problematic situation to a proper situation, where you untie the issue. So it's all connected. Yes?
So I think the right word here should be badil, sharia.
Badil is more of a substitute or alternative. So it could be, but it doesn't really show, you know, the nature it doesn't show the nature of this act or this kind of attitude. So there was an accusation. As I said, against Abu Hanifa, that he rejected the Sunnah, but that wasn't true. As we said, he just was very strict when it came to accepting the Hadith, because there was a lot of lying at his time. So he was very careful. And it was mentioned that sometimes, for example, someone came to Abu Hanifa and he said about the spoils of war, or about, you know, the spoils of war that you get, that the Muslim army gets without fighting, when the enemy surrenders and they hand everything they have. So Abu Hanifa was asked about this, and Abu Hanifa basically said, the soldier who's, I don't know what's the terms for that, but the soldier who's on foot and the soldier who's riding, they get the same share. So someone said to him, but the Prophet ﷺ, he gave double for the one who's riding. Abu Hanifa said, you know, that doesn't make sense. And he didn't reject the Hadith, but he was basically, as I said, this time it was there was excessive lying against the Prophet ﷺ. And for him, Abu Hanifa would stand by the principles of the Quran. So for him, there was justice. So what difference to him it doesn't make if someone is riding an animal or someone is fighting on his feet. So for him, this could not be from the Prophet ﷺ. This could not be from the Prophet ﷺ. So this is why he didn't take it. So a lot of the incidents happened with Abu Hanifa like this that led people to create this accusation. But as I said, it's not true. It's not true. Because we know in his fiqh, when he has an authentic hadith, he depends on it and he doesn't, you know, take anything else. He holds on to it. And there's a lot of statements from him that he says, if the hadith comes from the Prophet ﷺ, it's authentic, that's my madhab. That's my madhab. So we know that any instances where Abu Hanifa seemed to not to take a certain hadith, not because he rejects the hadith, but because he questions the authenticity. You remember as happened with Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and about the nafaqa of the woman when she is divorced for the third time, and Fatima bint Qais, she came and he said, Umar al-Khattab said, أَنَتْرُكُ قَوْلَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ لِقَوْلِ امْرَأَةٍ لَا نَدْرِي أَذَكَرَتْ أَمْ نَسِيَتْ. Are we going to leave something Allah said in the Quran for a statement from a woman that we don't know whether she remembered or she forgot? So that's exactly the same. So Abu Hanifa did not reject hadith. On the contrary, he would hold on to the hadith, but he was very careful as to how he would accept the hadith. Ibn Khaldun, he says, والإمام أبو حنيفة إنما قلت روايته لما شدد أو لما شدد في شروط الرواية والتحمل. He says Abu Hanifa, he has lesser number of hadith in his narrations and his fatawa, is because he was very strict when it came to accepting the narrations of the hadith. Yeah, so basically he explains this, and he says, when a hadith comes to him and the hadith is questioned by him, and he prefers to make qiyas rather than take a hadith that he questions or he's not sure of its authenticity. And when he finds a hadith that contradicts the general principles or seemingly contradicts the general principles in Islam, he questions it. And this is known by the scholars of hadith as naqdu al-matni. There's naqd al-isnad, there's criticism or study of the isnad, the chain of narration, and there is also naqd al-matn, or the study of the text of the hadith. Sometimes there's a hadith that when you study the text, you find there's something there that's not right. So that causes you to question it more and study more, and maybe you'll find a fault in it. There's a very important incident here, and it's actually worth mentioning it since we're talking about it. Ibn Abd al-Barr, he mentions this. He said, it was said to Abu Hanifa, there's someone in a state of ihram, hajj or umrah, and he doesn't find izar, the bottom towel. He doesn't find it. So can he wear his pants? Can he wear pants? He said, no. But he has to wear pants. So it says to him, but he doesn't find pants. Abu Hanifa says, no, he wears the izar. He's not supposed to wear the pants. He wears the izar. They tell him, but he doesn't have izar. So Abu Hanifa says, he sells his pants and he buys the izar, the towel, the bottom towel. So it was said to him, the Prophet ﷺ said that the one who's in a state of ihram, if he doesn't find the izar, the bottom towel, he can wear his pants. So Abu Hanifa says, this hadith is not verified to be authentic. So he had heard it. So he says, for me, this hadith has not been proven authentic from the Prophet ﷺ. And he says, وَيَنْتَهِي كُلُّ مْرِئٍ إِلَى مَا سَمِعٍ. And every person can only take from the hadith that he is sure of, what he has authentically heard. And that shows what Abu Hanifa is. And he says, وَقَدْ صَحَّ عِنْدَنَا. He says, and it's authentic with us, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ لَا يَلْبَسُ السَّرَاوِيلِ. And he says, we know for sure, authentically from the Prophet ﷺ, that one in a state of ihram, a person in a state of ihram, should not wear the pants. Should not wear the normal clothes and the pants. So he says, فَنَنْتَهِي إِلَى مَا سَمِعْنَا. So he says, we stand by what we know for sure from the Prophet ﷺ. So it was said to him, أَتُخَالِفُ النَّبِيَّ ﷺ. So do you contradict the Prophet ﷺ? He said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ يُخَالِفُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وسلم بِهِ أُكْرِمْنَا وَبِهِ اسْتُنْقِذْنَا. He says, may Allah's curse be upon anyone who contradicts the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He's the one through which Allah dignified us and saved us from the hellfire. So you can see, he doesn't reject the hadith, but he only takes the hadith that he finds to be authentic. So he's very careful about which hadith to take. The madhab of Imam Abi Hanifa mainly was written by his students. His fiqh was mainly documented by his students. And there's a Kitab al-Fiqh al-Akbar, the book of al-Fiqh al-Akbar. And it's said to have around 60,000 mas'ala, like 60,000 fatwas or issues of fiqh. And there's another book as well that's ascribed to him, Al-Fiqh Al-Akbar, that's on Aqeedah. But this book is written by his, mainly documented by his students. It's a book of fiqh. But as I said, most of the madhab of Abu Hanifa was mainly documented by his students. And the students who really stand out, the main two students of Abu Hanifa that stand out is Imam Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani and Abu Yusuf al-Qadi. Abu Yusuf al-Qadi and Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani. So their books are considered to be references in the Hanafi fiqh, the main references. By Abu Yusuf, there is the book of Al-Athar, Kitab al-Athar. There's Al-Kharaj, which is the most famous, by Abu Yusuf. And he has a book, a third book, Ikhtilafu Abi Hanifa wa Ibn Abi Layla. These are just for your information. Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani has many books, Al-Jami' al-Kabir, Al-Jami' al-Saghir, والسير الكبير والسير الصغير والزيادات. And he also has a book Al-Asl, which is one of his most important books. The Hanafi madhab was mainly in Iraq, then it spread to the Persia sub-Indian continent and even the borders of China, the borders of China. And most of the non-Arab lands they adopted, most of the non-Arab lands, that means the Turks, Asia Minor, sub-Indian continent, most of them, they adopted the Hanafi madhab. So his madhab, because his students spread everywhere and they taught his madhab. And also the madhab of Abu Hanifa was taken as the formal madhab by the Ottomans, Al-Khilaf Al-Uthmaniyya. So they, obviously that led, since it was the official madhab of fiqh, so that led to more of the spreading of the madhab of Abi Hanifa. So generally speaking, that's it. When we say madhab Abu Hanifa, doesn't mean all of it is from Abu Hanifa. The principles, the main issues are taken from Abu Hanifa. But later on, they were developed by the scholars. So when we say a madhab, we're not saying it's the opinion of one scholar. No, that's the work that started with a scholar, the imam, and then it was developed, was scrutinized, was increased, was enhanced by the students and the students and the students. So when we say a madhab, we're talking about a school of thought. We're talking about a school of thought. We're not dealing with one person. And the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa is one of the probably best examples there, because his student Abu Yusuf al-Qadi had different fatawa, huge number of fatawa that are different from Abu Hanifa. And what we have today is the Hanafi fiqh. Not all of it straights back to Abu Hanifa. But the principles, yes, they're taken from Abu Hanifa. But a lot of the fatawa there, a lot of them are actually from Abu Yusuf al-Qadi himself. From Abu Yusuf, and some of his fatawa are actually in contradiction to the fatawa of Abu Hanifa, and there's nothing wrong with this. There's nothing wrong with this, because Abu Yusuf al-Qadi obviously had some interest more in hadith, so he would change some of the fatawa when he found a hadith that was not in line, that when the fatwa was not in line with it, he would change that. And this is what Abu Hanifa taught them. Okay, so generally speaking, that's what we had to say about Abu Hanifa and his madhab. Let's move on to Imam Malik. Imam Malik was born year 93 after Hijrah, so 13 years after Abu Hanifa. And Abu Hanifa, by the way, died 150. Abu Hanifa died year 150. And that's the year most likely Imam Shafi'i was born. So Imam Shafi'i was born the year Abu Hanifa died. Imam Malik was born 93 and passed away 179. Imam Malik lived more, spent more time in the Abbasi Khilafah. And Imam Malik was born in Medina. He grew up in Medina. He comes from an Arab origin. And his qabila, or his tribe, is the Asbah from Yemen originally. So he was born and raised in Medina. He lived most of his life in Medina. He didn't seek knowledge outside of Medina, except probably some travels that he, when he went to Mecca or something. So he was influenced greatly by Manhaj Ahlul Hadith, or the school of thought of Ahlul Hadith. Okay, Ahlul Hadith. By the way, that's not what you know in India and Pakistan today is Ahlul Hadith, right? That's a group in India and Pakistan. It has a lot of similarity, yeah? It draws on the same principles, but we're not talking about them. Ahl al-Hadith, at the time, it was mainly in Hijaz, focused mainly on the text and the Hadith, and not resorting to opinion and to ijtihad a lot. In contradiction to the what was in Iraq, Ahl al-Ra'i, which were more in line with making ijtihad and using reason. So Imam Malik, from a young age, he memorized the Qur'an and he sat with the scholars and he learned from one of the main scholars of Medina, Abdul Rahman ibn Hurmuz. That's probably his first teacher. And probably the main teacher as well. And then he learned from Nafi', Mawla ibn Umar, the servant of Ibn Umar. We know Nafi' is one of the great scholars of Medina. And he took from Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri. He learned from him a lot. And he also took fiqh from Rabi'a, who's known as Rabi'at al-Ra'i. Rabi'at al-Ra'i. That's Rabi'at al-Ra'i, who used to ask Sa'id ibn Musayyib, and Sa'id ibn Musayyib said to him, أمن العراقي أنت؟ Are you from Iraq? So this is why he's called ربيعة الرأي. He has ربيعة of opinion and reason, because he used to question things. And he also took from the Qadi, or the judge of Medina, the main judge in Medina, Yahya bin Sa'id al-Ansari, very well known scholar of Hadith. And he took from the seven Fuqaha of Medina. And his teachers took from the seven Fuqaha of Medina. So we said, if you remember, that the Fiqh of Medina all gathered in Imam Malik. It was like the melting point of all this fiqh. It was handed down and it was combined in one person, Imam Malik. So Imam Malik, we said that he said, ما جلست للتدريس حتى شهد لي أربعون من علماء المدينة ومن أئمة المدينة. He said, I did not sit to teach until 40 of the scholars of Medina gave me permission. Imam Malik was mainly, he did not like do a business or have a job or anything. Basically, he lived at a very basic level, but he had a brother called An-Nadr, and he used to do business and trade. So Imam Malik used to, you know, do a little bit of business with him. And they used to sell and buy. So it was his brother. So he used to probably buy some shares with his brother, and his brother would do the business, and that kept him to survive. Imam Malik was known for his sense of serenity and respect. So he was known for sakina and waqar. So he had a lot of respect and a sense of awe that people had towards him. And he would not speak a lot. And it was mentioned Imam Malik, every time that he would teach hadith, he would oil his hair and comb it, and his beard. And he would wear the best clothes. He says, because I am teaching the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, I have to be in the best shape. So he used to oil his hair and wear perfume and wear the best of his clothes every time he taught hadith. فَكَانَ يَتَزَيَّنُ لِلْتَحْدِيثِ. Okay. He went through some hardships because he was accused of something that has to do with a fatwa. But anyway, and he was he was actually tortured, and at some stage his shoulders got pulled from opposite sides to the extent that he could not even put his hands here when he prayed. So he put his hands down. He could not hold them. So his shoulders got pulled. Okay, so that caused some damage to his shoulders and arms. So he could not put his hands down. This is why some of the Malikis until today, not all of them, some of the Maliki followers of the Maliki Madhab, if you notice, sometimes they pray, they put their hands down. Okay, sometimes they put their, some of those people put their hands down. Okay, Imam Malik, as I said, he took from the Imams of Medina, and his general manhaj was basically that the Quran and the Sunnah. You take from the Quran and the Sunnah. But for him, there was a very important thing, which is عمل أهل المدينة. What أهل المدينة, or the residents of Medina, were upon. Because for him, that's the city of the Prophet ﷺ. That's where the scholars were, that's where the companions were, the majority of the companions were. So what they were upon was what they learned from the Prophet ﷺ. Imam Malik had a very great interest in hadith. So he compiled his book Al-Muwatta. Al-Muwatta. And we said it was, Al-Muwatta was a collection of a hadith, fatawa from the companions, fatawa from at-tabi'een, and a little bit fatawa sometimes from him, his own opinion. His own opinion. So that was Al-Muwatta of Al-Imam Malik. And just to show you how Imam Malik dealt, probably the Al-Muwatta is the oldest complete book of hadith of that size, like big collection of hadith, at that size that was maintained until today, that survived until today. How Imam Malik dealt with differences? Imam Malik was aware that people in Iraq had a different fiqh. So Al-Khalifa Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, he asked him to make Al-Muwatta the book or the like the constitution for the Muslim Khilafah, for the Caliphate. So Abu Hanifa said, but in Iraq they have a different fiqh and they don't accept our fiqh. So he refused to force people to follow his own understand his own book, his own understanding, his own fiqh. He said people have, because he's not talking about people, he's talking about scholars. He says there are scholars there and they have a different understanding, they have a different fiqh. So how can I impose my own fiqh on their fiqh? So he actually refused that. Even Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, you're going to see this statement where Abu Ja'far al-Mansur requested from him. Yes, Abu Ja'far al-Mansur asked Imam Malik, he said, اجعل العلم يا أبا عبد الله علما واحدا. Let the knowledge of the people be one. This combined people upon one understanding. So Malik said to him, إِنَّ أَصْحَابَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ تَفَرَّقُوا فِي الْبِلَادِ فَأَفْتَى كُلٌّ فِي عَصْرِهِ بِمَا رَأَى. He said, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ dispersed over the lands. They spread over the lands. So each one of them, in their own time, they gave a fatwa based on their assessment of the situations they dealt with. وَإِنَّ لِأَهْلِ هَذَا الْبَلَدِ أَيْ مَكَّةِ قَوْلًا. He said, for the people of Mecca here, there's an opinion, or there is a fatwa. And for the people of Medina, there's another fatwa. The people of Iraq, they have another opinion about the same issue. قَدْ تَعَدَّوْا فِيهِ طَوْرَهُمْ. Anyway, فقال, so the Khalifa said, Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, it seems that he met Imam Malik in Mecca. So he said to him, as for the people of Iraq, he said, أَمَّا أَهْلُ الْعِرَاقِ فَلَسْتُ أَقْبَلُ مِنْهُمْ صَرْفًا وَلَا عَدْلًا. The Khalifa said, as for the people of Iraq, I don't accept anything from them. That's the Khalifa said. So he said, فَضَعْ لِلنَّاسِ الْعِلْمِ. So get people, put the knowledge for people to take it. So Malik said to him, إِنَّ أَهْلَ الْعِرَاقِ لَا يَرْضَوْنَ عِلْمَنَا. He said, the people of Iraq, they don't accept my knowledge, our knowledge here in Medina. So the Khalifa Abu Ja'far said to him, يُضْرَبُ عَلَيْهِ عَمَّتُهُمْ بِالسَّيْفِ. He said, we will force it upon them on sword point. They will have to accept it. وَتُقْطَعُ عَلَيْهِ ظُهُورُهُمْ بِالسِّيَاطِ. And we will like lash them and whip them by force, make them hold on to it. But Imam Malik refused to do this. And Imam Malik spent a lot of his time, a big chunk of his time writing his book Al-Muwatta. Anyway, the fatawa of Imam Malik, where Imam Malik did not write his own fatawa, he did not write them down, but they were written down by his students, by his students. And this is why we have what we call Al-Mudawwana. Al-Mudawwana basically has the fatawa of Imam Malik written down. For the Muwatta, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote acceptance to this book. كتب الله له القبول. So it was, it spread and people made copies of it and studied it and benefited from it, and it was narrated by some of his students. This is why sometimes we have little variations. So we have now two versions of Al-Muwatta. They're pretty much the same, but there are some differences. So let's say around 75-80% they are the same, but in that 20% there are differences, some additions in another one. So we have one that is reported, and interestingly, by Mohamed bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani. Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani, who is the student of Abu Hanifa as well. And Imam Malik and Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani were very good together, very good. So Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani studied with Abu Hanifa, and then he moved to Medina. First he met Imam Malik in Mecca, then he moved to Medina in order to learn from him. So he learned from Imam Malik, and he took from him his Muwatta. So one of the versions or editions that we have on Muwatta is narrated by Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani. And the second version we have is from Yahya bin Yahya al-Laythi. Yahya bin Yahya al-Laythi. And this is probably the most common today. Riwayat al-Muwatta by Yahya bin Yahya. Recently, the last couple, 10 years probably, there's a collection that came, the Muwatta, according to 11 narrations, 11 editions. So some of the like the manuscripts were found where they managed to get probably 11 versions of Al-Muwatta. As I said, they're very close to each other, small variations here and there. Which, the one we had in Egypt? No, that's Al-Layth ibn Sa'd. Al-Layth ibn Sa'd is different. Al-Layth ibn Sa'd is different. And Al-Layth ibn Sa'd had, he used to exchange letters with Imam Malik, because they lived at the same time. So they used to give advice to each other. So Imam Malik's fiqh was written down by his students. And they were collected in what we call Al-Mudawwana. Al-Mudawwana means more of a compilation. It's a compilation. And it was written by Asad bin al-Furat. By Asad bin al-Furat. Asad bin al-Furat took it from the students of Imam Malik, and he put all these fatawa together. And he himself actually met Imam Malik, and he met Imam Malik. Yes, he studied with Imam Malik. So the way he collected Al-Mudawwana was that he met Muhammad bin Hassan. He went to Iraq after the death of Imam Malik. He went to Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani and took from him everything that he learned from Imam Malik, all the fatawa. Then he went to Egypt and he met Abdul Rahman bin al-Qasim, another student of Imam Malik. And he took from him all the fatawa that he learned from Imam Malik. And then he took all of this to Tunisia, to North Africa, to Tunisia, to Al-Qayrawan, the city of Al-Qayrawan. And then it was copied by a man called Sahnoun. Okay, or Suhnoon. Suhnoon or Suhnoon, that's the Mudawwana that we have today. It's his copy. It's his copy that we have, that was the main script for that. Okay. Now, the general features of Madhab of Imam Malik. First of all, it was the Quran is the main source of legislation. And obviously, number two is the Sunnah, the Hadith. The Hadith is the second source of legislation. But Imam Malik, being a scholar of Hadith, he was very careful about which Hadith to take. About which Hadith to take. And he had knowledge about the Rijal. He had knowledge about the narrators of Hadith. He had very specific, very good knowledge of the narrators of Hadith. And he's considered, like, if you go to the books of Al-Rijal, you will find a lot of comments from Imam Malik. A lot of comments from Imam Malik as to which hadith to be accepted. So he was considered one of the main scholars of Ilm al-Rijal. The third feature of Imam Malik's madhab is Amalu Ahl al-Madina, as we said. So for him, whatever the people or the residents of Medina were upon, for him that was a main source of legislation. Not that it initiates a legislation, but it explains how we understand the Quran and the hadith. So he would see how Ahlul Medina deal with this verse, what do they take from it, how do they implement it. That's for him the understanding. Okay, so for him, the amal Ahlul Medina, what Ahlul Medina were upon, puts the Quran and Sunnah in the right context for him. And then the statements of the companions, that's number four. The statements of the companions occupied a very important position in the fiqh of Imam Malik. So what the companions agreed upon, he would take this. But if they had conflicting or differing statements, he would take the ones that are closer to the Quran and the Sunnah in his assessment. Something very important about the fiqh of Imam Malik is something called al-masalih al-mursala, open benefits. Al-masalih al-mursala. And this is a big feature of his madhab. Al-masalih al-mursala. Al-masalih al-mursala means anything that is good for him is part of Islam. Anything that's good and beneficial, inherently good and beneficial to human beings, for him, this falls under Islam enjoins what's good and forbids what's evil. Anything that's good. So this is why, and actually it's from this feature that the science of maqasid al-sharia was born, the objectives of sharia. And this is why the first one to establish this science and write in it and document it and systemize it was al-Imam al-Shatibi. Al-Imam al-Shatibi. Imam al-Shatibi was a Maliki. He was a Maliki scholar, Imam al-Shatibi. And it's based on al-Masalih al-Mursala, the principle, this important principle in Madhab al-Imam Malik. Al-Masalih al-Mursala, open benefits. For him, this was the main established, or the main cornerstone in the building of the science of al-Maqasid. In the science of al-Maqasid. For example, there was an issue that a fatwa that was presented to Imam Malik. Saffron, very expensive saffron. It used to be brought from Persia. At his time, it appeared that some merchants came up with bogus saffron, fake saffron, and they were selling it in the market. So some of them were caught. So the fatwa came to Imam Malik, what to deal with these people. Okay, so we have saffron, it's in their possession, they have it in their stores, in the storage rooms. What should we do with this? The fatwa, the common fatwa at the time was, it should be taken and destroyed. It should be taken and destroyed. Now, bogus saffron wasn't good enough, but it was like a very low quality, but still was some kind of saffron, low quality saffron. Imam Malik's opinion was, no, don't destroy it. Don't destroy it. The destruction of it was basically a punishment for these people, for merchants. So, was a deterrent factor that anyone who buys or gets this kind of low quality saffron, it would be confiscated and destroyed. Imam Malik's opinion was, no. Confiscate it, take it from them, and give it to the poor people, so they benefit from it. Because they don't get anything. So that's masalih al-mursala, open benefits. So whatever there is something, any beneficial choice, he would actually go for it and he would consider it to be part of Sharia, because Sharia for him was sent down to bring about good and maximize good and reduce harm and evil. So whatever falls under this for him was considered to be part of Sharia. This is al-masalih al-mursala. Then a less important feature of his madhab was al-qiyas, analogy. So he would use al-qiyas when there is no text on the issue from the Quran or the Sunnah, no statement from a companion, then only then he would use qiyas, analogy. So for example, one of the fatwa of Imam Malik was if a woman was in her menses and then she became clean and there's no water for her to make ghusl. She has to make ghusl after her menses. Can she make tayammum? There's nothing in the Quran about this, nothing in the Sunnah. Okay, he doesn't know, and he, for him, nothing from the companions came about this. So he was asked, what should she do? He said, we make qiyas. If she's junub, if she's in a state of impurity and janaba, no water, the Quran states that she can make tayammum. This is similar to this. So we make analogy here. Menses, is we consider it similar to janaba. So she makes tayammum if she doesn't find water. And then she, that's it, she can pray. So that's one of the issues of qiyas. Another important issue with or feature of his madhab was saddu dhara'i', blocking the means to haram. Saddu dhara'i'. And this is a very big thing, and it has to do with maqasid, by the way. If something is halal, but if you do it, you are more likely to slip into the haram. He says, haram. He says that's haram. Even the halal becomes haram. Why? Because it leads to haram. It leads to haram. And there are so many things in Islam that are actually, and this caused the classification in the in fiqh as to محرم لذاته ومحرم سدا للذريعة. The things that are haram in Islam, this is something that's known now among the scholars. It's either haram in and of itself because it's evil, like zina. Zina, fornication, is haram in and of itself. But shaking a woman's hand, محرم سدا للذريعة, is not haram in its own. Mixing between men and women, originally, it's not supposed to be haram. But it was made haram in Islam. Islam considered it to be haram. Why? Because it leads to zina. Ultimately, not necessarily in every case, but when there is more mixing, you will have more zina. So this is why it was made haram. Same thing, shaking the hands of the opposite sex. Originally, okay, it's not haram and by and of itself, because of itself. No, but it was made haram in Islam. Why? Because it leads to more mixing. It's, okay, touching the hand of a woman could lead some people to falling into zina. So this is why it was made haram in Islam. So what you, everything you find in Islam, it's either haram because of itself, muharramun lidatihi, or it is made haram because it leads to a haram, although there is some benefit in it. Okay? Now I'm not saying now what is made haram because it leads to haram, now it was made haram, that this is something that's not mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah. No, there are many things that are made haram in the Quran and the Sunnah, were made so. Why? Because they lead to something haram. Because they lead to something haram. So the muharram in Islam is two types. Muharramun lidatihi wa muharramun saddan lidhari'a. So it's muharram, either haram by itself because of its own nature, it's evil, or it's haram because it's not necessarily or inherently evil, but because it leads, it's most likely to lead to haram. So this is why it was made haram. Why is this classification? It's important. Because the scholars, for example, say, ما حرم سدا للذريعة أبيح للحاجة. What was made haram, not because of itself, but it was made haram because it leads to haram, leads to a greater haram. When there is a need, it becomes halal. When there is difficulty, it's made halal. It's made halal. But what is haram by itself can only, you know, you can only commit it or you can only fall into it when there is a state of necessity. Necessity means there is death. There is death. So there is darura, necessity, and there is haja, some basic need, some normal, casual need. Okay? Is this point clear? Okay? So when something is haram by itself, it only can be like committed or taken or used in extreme cases. In extreme cases, when someone's life is on the line, when someone's honor is on the line, when some extreme hardship. But what is made haram سَدًّا لِلذَّرِيعَ, because it leads to haram. Then when there is some casual need, a great level of discomfort, not necessity, a great level of discomfort, then it's we make a concession there. Okay, this is why the scholars today, say for example, shaking a woman's hand, they say you don't shake woman's hand, but if you get into a position, let's say you're meeting, like it happened one day in Europe, I believe in Holland, there was imam of a masjid, and there was a huge big celebration for the Muslim community, and the prime minister came, and she was a female, and she extended her hand for him to shake it. And the whole of Holland was watching this. And the guy pulled back his hand, the imam. We appreciate his sense of righteousness, but it was like a slap on her face. She took offense, and like it created a lot of negativity about the Muslim community. We're not saying go and shake women's hands. This is why the scholars today, when they are asked, and if you ask them, and the most, by the way, the most strict scholars ask them today, they say don't shake women's hands. But if you get in a position where it's very uncomfortable, and the woman extends her hand, then you shake your hands. That's the fatwa of some of the scholars that some people consider to be extreme. But for me, I see these people to be scholars to be trying to hold on to the Quran and the Sunnah. So we have to be careful about this. So the haram in Islam is not at the same level. This feature of Imam Malik's madhab, this feature was very apparent in Imam Malik's madhab. For example, Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, the Khalifa, he wanted to demolish the Kaaba and build it as the Prophet ﷺ wanted to, on the foundations of Ibrahim. Because the Kaaba is not the same, the original shape of the Kaaba is not the shape we know today. You know Hijr Ismail, that curve? That's a wall of the Kaaba originally. So the Kaaba is supposed to take that shape. The Prophet ﷺ said to Aisha, لولا أن قومك حديث عهد بجاهلية لهدمت الكعبة ولبنيتها على قواعد إبراهيم. إلى آخر الحديث. The Prophet ﷺ said to Aisha, had it not been for the fact that your people, basically the Arabs, have just come out of Jahiliyyah, I would have demolished the Kaaba and rebuilt it upon the foundations of Ibrahim and the real shape of it. So Abu Ja'far al-Mansur wanted to do that. So he consulted Imam Malik. What did Imam Malik say? Imam said, Anshuduk Allah, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. He said, O Amir, O Chief of the Believers, I ask you by Allah, لا تجعل هذا البيت ملعبة للملوك بعدك لا يشاء أحد منهم أن يغيره إلا غيره فتذهب هيبته من قلوب الناس. He says, O Chief of the Believers, I ask you by Allah, don't do this. Because I'm afraid the kings after you will take more liberty. Each one is going to change the Kaaba as they wish. And then it will become more like a play, more like a toy to play with. So people will lose respect for the house of Allah every time it's demolished. It's easily demolished and rebuilt. So please don't do this. So he basically considered it for him to be haram to do this, although the Prophet ﷺ wanted to do it. Why? Because it's going to lead to haram. It's not only something halal, it's something that is actually highly recommended. Highly recommended. But سَدًّا لِلذَّرِيعَ, to block that as a means to more evil, he said, don't do it. The madhab of Imam Malik spread mostly in North Africa, until today, mainly in North Africa. So it was taken, first it was in Medina, it was more taken a little bit into Egypt, and then mainly in North, and it was mainly by Suhnun who took it. And remember, Al-Mudawwana was basically documented mainly by Suhnun and became popular. So it took root in North Africa, and this is why now we see most of the Al-Maghrib Al-Arabi are Malikis. And then it was in Al-Andalus as well. In Al-Andalus. So it took root in Spain. Anyway. So Suhnun is the main one who spread the madhab, and it was also in Egypt. There was Ibn al-Majishun in Egypt as well. Yeah, that's it, basically. Sicily as well was upon the, when it was a Muslim land, it was upon the Madhab al-Maliki. And in Iraq a little bit, it appeared, the Maliki Madhab appeared there, but then it didn't last for long. It didn't last for long, so it was mainly in North Africa and Spain. So that's the Madhab of Imam Maliki. I think it's enough for today. Inshallah, next time we will cover Imam Shafi'i and his madhab, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and his madhab. As for the, I believe most of those who suggested topics for research, that we approved of their research. And this is a good research. Industrial animal farming, do we only remember to make it halal as slaughter? Looking at the principles of Islam, not only about the slaughter, but how we deal with animals before that as well. It's a very good thing, and I think that's something that's really needed. We need to address that today. So I think that's a very good, I looked through it. It's a very good, mashallah, topic. So go ahead with it, do it, mashallah. Excellent.